Hi everyone, this is Manas, your friend and tutor, and guys, I'm back with another video on engineering drawing for ESE prelims, and this is going to be very, very important. Well guys, if you have subscribed to my channel, then you must have seen the previous video that was based on the concept development and the understanding of all sorts of engineering curves. Well, do watch that video if you haven't. And if you have seen that, then all the 30 to 40 problems which I have in store for you in this particular video, well, they're going to be very, very easy to crack. So assuming that you have seen that video, let us kick off and here we go. So we've got problem number one, and here we go. Which of the following statements are correct? Okay, so the first statement says the locus traced by a point in such a way that the sum of its distances from two fixed points is always constant is called an ellipse. Well, that's a right statement. Okay, and if you have seen the previous video, you should know that if a point P moves in such a way that the distance from fixed points, let us say F1, and the distance of that same point from F2, it is same, it is always constant. So that's true. Let me show you that with the help of this figure. You see, this point P is moving in such a manner, if you take this sum PF1 plus PF2, okay, and if you take another point, let's say you reach here, P1. So P1F1 plus again P1F2, it's going to be equal to constant. Always this value is going to be same. And let me go ahead and tell you that this constant is nothing but the length of the major axis. So this statement is absolutely correct. So let me put a C over here. Fine. Second statement, the eccentricity of a parabola is less than the eccentricity of a hyperbola. Well guys, the eccentricity of a parabola is actually equal to 1, and the eccentricity of a hyperbola is actually greater than 1. So obviously the eccentricity of a parabola is less than that of a hyperbola. So this also is a correct statement. What about this third statement? In case of an ellipse, the distance of an end of the major axis, so let's say this end, from any focus, let's say from this focus 1, is equal to half of the minor axis. Now this is absolutely ridiculous. This distance is not the half of minor axis. We know that very well. Okay, so this statement is incorrect. So the option that we are going to take on, 1 and 2 are correct. So option A, that's the right answer. Let's move ahead. Which of the following statements are correct? Again, a helix is a 2D locus. No man, helix rather is a 3D locus, and it's something like this. Okay, the spring is the best example of a rather cylindrical helix, and that's the locus of a point moving in three dimensions. So that's an incorrect statement. So the correct statements are, let's check them. A line joining the midpoint of two parallel chords of a parabola is parallel to its axis. Man, this is something which I had not discussed in the video, but let me take the opportunity to explain you this. So let us first have a parabola. Okay, that's the parabola, and what we do have is a line joining the midpoint of two parallel chords. Now guys, randomly I'm going to be making one chord and another chord parallel to this one, and these two chords are going to have their midpoints also, and their midpoints are to be joined, and the line joining the midpoint is going to be parallel to the axis. So once I make the midpoint, another midpoint, once I join this line, this should be absolutely parallel to the axis. Well, that's true. So this statement is also true. This statement is also true. And why is this statement true? Because let me tell you something. You have an hyperbola. These are the asymptotes of a hyperbola. Okay. Hyperbola is something like this. These are not two separate curves, but collectively, this is what you call a hyperbola. And this is basically the asymptote. Let me tell you, this is the asymptote. Asymptote. And the interesting definition of asymptote is, if you keep on tracing this curve, you'll keep on going ahead and ahead, and this asymptote is also going to go ahead and ahead, but this curve will never meet this line. Okay, so asymptote is basically a line which meets the curve at, because we have not seen that they are coming closer, but they do not meet. So it meets the curve at infinity. Okay, asymptote is a line. Let me write this. Asymptote is a line which meets the curve at infinity. So that's it. And here the angle is always less than 90 degrees. And if that angle is equal to 90 degree, then it's not a simple hyperbola. It has got to be a rectangular hyperbola. Now, guys, you can note this down. This is going to be extremely important for the coming problems also. Whenever the angle between the asymptotes is less than 90 degree, it's a simple hyperbola. And if the angle is equal to 90 degrees, it's a rectangular hyperbola. So what do we have? Option 2 and 3 are correct. 2 and 3. Option B. Done. Next. Which of the following statements are correct? Two normals can be drawn at any point on an Archimedean spiral. Well, Archimedean spiral is also a curve, sort of. And you cannot draw two normals at one single point. That is absolutely ridiculous. Okay. So this option, well, that's gone. Okay. If one is gone, so option A is gone and option C is gone. You just have to take this 2 and 3 into the picture. Locus of a point equidistant from a fixed line. Okay, so let us try to make a fixed line. And is a line perpendicular to the fixed line? Now, there is a point which moves in such a manner that it always maintains equal distance. Let's say that the point initially is here, then the point is going to be here. And it is moving in such a manner that this distance is always going to remain same. Wherever this point goes, this distance always remains same. And when you join all these points, so this locus in fact is what? Is a line. And this line is actually parallel to this fellow over here. So the line is going to be parallel and not perpendicular. Okay. What about this one? Third, the study of loci of points is needed in designing electronic circuits. Well, electronic circuits has nothing to do with this loci of points. Loci of points is associated with mechanism. Remember this. This is going to be very helpful for you. Loci of points is associated with mechanism or machines which have some rotating parts and elements. So none of the options are correct. Option D. Moving on. The ratio of the distance of a point on a conic from the focus to the distance of point from the directrix. Okay, here it is. Distance of any point P from focus divided by distance of the same point from directrix is nothing but the eccentricity. Okay, so maybe there might be a parabola like this. So distance of a point on parabola, rather I should say, if there is a point P on the parabola, its distance from focus, okay, let's say PF, divided by the distance of that same point from directrix, okay, say PC. This ratio is what is referred to as eccentricity. That's option number D. Okay. Fourth problem, where is it gone? Yeah, here it is. Boyle's law. PV is equal to C generates a curve, which is, we need to work it out. PV is equal to constant. Okay, let's say we have this X and this is Y. PV is equal to constant. Similarly, XY is equal to constant. Let me have this X and Y. Okay. Now, for some value of X, there is going to be some value of Y. If you try putting the values of X, say 1, 2, 3, 4, you're going to get the corresponding values of Y as, let's say, C over 1, C over 2, C over 3, and C over 4, and so on, and so forth. In that case, you will be getting a curve something like this. Okay? So this in fact is a rectangular hyperbola. Why? The reason being, if you keep on making more points, say 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, if you go on and on and on and on, and if you extend this, well, these two, this curve and this line will never meet. And this line is what you know as an asymptote. Okay, fine. That has nothing to do. This over here is nothing but the volume and this over here is the pressure. So the PV curve is nothing but a rectangular hyperbola. Why? The reason being very simple. This also is an asymptote, vertical one. This also is an asymptote, horizontal one. And they are making an angle of how much? 90 degrees. Always remember, XY is equal to C is nothing but a rectangular hyperbola. And in the case of Boyle's law, PV is equal to constant is nothing but the rectangular hyperbola, where the angle between asymptotes is 90 degrees. Done. Next, the line joining any point on an Archimedean spiral with the pole is called the, well, this is very simple. This is radius vector. Moving on. If the generating point is on the generating circle and the generating circle is outside the directing circle, the curve obtained is, Just think about this, guys. There is a generating circle and there is a directing circle. Directing circle is fixed. And we have a generating circle outside. What sort of a curve is it going to trace? If we are tracking a point which lies on the circumference itself, the condition is something like this. Okay, like this. This is the rolling circle or the generating circle, and this over here is the directing circle. So if you keep a track of this point on the circumference, this is what you get. This curve is popularly known as what? Just think about this. Think about this. This is an epicycloid. Okay, pretty easy. So that's over. Moving ahead. Okay, yeah. So a gear tooth profile is in the form of, well, the gear tooth profile is of the involute form. Let me show you why. Here is the reason. You can see, let's say that there is a string wound, okay, and we are lifting that string, keeping it extremely tight, we are lifting that string. This profile is what is referred to as an involute. And with the help of this profile, gear tooths are made. Let me give you some more intuition. Let me draw a line something like this, and let me make a line over here. Okay, if you mirror this shape about this line, we'll have a figure something like this. And this actually is a gear tooth. Okay, this is a gear tooth, which can be arrayed in a circular manner, and then the number of tooths can be increased. So that's the entire idea as to how gear tooths are actually constructed on drawing sheet or paper, whatever. So what's the gear tooth is of the form of, well, an involute. That's the right option. So the next problem is the sum of distances of any point on the ellipse from the foci is equal to sum of the distances. That means PF1 plus PF2. You need to pick up any point on the ellipse, join it with focus 1, join it with focus 2, take the sum PF1 plus PF2. This sum will always work out as, okay, that is the major axis. Major axis. Remember this, and if you have seen the video, you will remember this. Option B is the right one. So moving on, let's take this one. This appears a bit interesting. The curve traced out by an end of string unwound from a circle or polygon, keeping it tight, is, well, just let me read this once again. The curve traced out by an end of string unwound from a circle or polygon, keeping it always tight. Well, this is the case of an involute. But the option, we don't have the option of involute. We know whenever we either wound or unwound a string or a rope or something like that from a circle or a polygon, we always get an involute profile. But none of the options are of involute. That's the option. None. 11th. Name the curve traced out by a point moving in a plane such that the difference between its distances from the two fixed points is constant. Guys, remember this. Sum property is for ellipse and difference property is for hyperbola. I'll show you that. Let me reiterate. And here it is. These are two fixed points. There is going to be a point P. Let's say this one over here. This distance, PF1 and PF2. Let's say we have this PF2 minus PF1. Let's take another point. This is P1, by the way. P2. Okay. Now, you take this distance, P2, F2 minus P2, F1. These values are going to be same. Okay. And this is nothing but the case of a hyperbola. The value that you are going to get will always be a constant. So that's it. Let me show you how this looks. And once you join all the points, this is precisely what you are going to get. That's a hyperbola. And let me go ahead and tell you, this distance, this constant, is nothing but the distance between the vertices. In case of ellipse, it was the length of major axis. And in case of hyperbola, it is the distance between the vertices. That's it. So what is the right option? The curve traced out is a hyperbola. Next problem. When a bullet is shot in the air. Okay, so we have got a bullet like this. And when it is shot in the air, let's say you are hitting it horizontally from the top of a building, your hands are like this and you're shooting it. It's going to come under the effect of gravity after some time, and it's going to trace a path like this, like this, like this. So it's going to be a parabolic path. Option C is right. When a right circular cone is cut by a plane passing through its apex. So we have a cutting plane which passes through the apex. What is the curve that you are going to get? So this green colored plane you have is the cutting plane, and this is the cone over here. If it passes through the apex, just think about this. What sort of a conic section are you going to achieve? Well, it's a triangle. Here is the proof. Okay, it is passing through the apex, and the stuff that you are going to get, whatever angle it is, does not matter. What matters is, if the cutting plane passes through the apex, the conic section that we obtain is a triangle. Done. When a right circular cone is cut which meets its axis at an angle greater than the semi-apex angle or the semi-vertical angle, the curve obtained is, okay, let me have the figure. This over here, guys, is the semi-vertical angle, let's say alpha. Okay, this is actually the axis, and this is nothing but the cutting plane. Fine. The angle that the cutting plane makes with the axis is what you refer to as beta. Now you can clearly see alpha is less than beta, or you can also say that beta is greater than alpha. So you can clearly see meets the axis at an angle greater, beta is greater than alpha. Since this cutting plane is passing through all the generators, if you watch carefully, you will have a generator here, you will have a generator here, and beta greater than alpha is a condition for which conic section? It is a condition for ellipse. So that is the correct answer. Okay, when a right circular cone is cut which meets its axis at an angle less than the semi-apex angle. Now this is very easy. Let's have the figure. What is this? This is angle alpha, and if I can just extend this slightly, and if I can just extend this also, this angle over here is beta, and you can clearly see angle beta is less than angle alpha. So as long as beta is less than alpha, the conic section that you are going to get is a hyperbola. Again, I'll say, if you have seen the previous video, engineering curves for ESE prelims, this is going to be a very, very easy session for you all. So moving on, next problem, the angle between the asymptotes of a rectangular hyperbola. Now guys, I have already told you, a rectangular hyperbola is something of this sort, and here the asymptotes are at an angle of 90 degrees. So this is the right option. Name the curve which has eccentricity is equal to 1. That's pretty simple. Eccentricity less than 1 is an ellipse. Eccentricity equal to 1 is this fellow, that is a parabola, and you know that for hyperbola it is greater than 1. Moving on, in which of the following applications is the hyperbolic curve used? Well, it's the cooling tower. In nuclear power plants, you'll see these cooling towers, something like this. Okay, huge structures. These are the cooling towers. Okay, from which gaseous matter are released. So that's it. Okay, this appears very interesting. The eccentricity of an ellipse can be determined by. This is a very interesting problem. One way of determining the eccentricity is this one. So distance of a point on ellipse from focus. Yes. Okay, that is PF. Eccentricity, we know, point, its distance from focus divided by the same point, its distance from directrix. Let's say C is any point on the directrix. So this option is correct. So some of you guys won't even see these two options, and they are going to immediately take on option C, and they are going to go ahead. But that is a very, very wrong way of approaching a problem. You should work out also options A and option B, because these two options are also correct. And let me tell you the reason why. Here it is. So if you see this diagram is for eccentricity is equal to 2/3, and 2/3, by the way, is less than 1, and that's why it is for an ellipse. Fine. Distance of focus is how much? Well, this has to be CF. This was already given to me in the problem. The CF was 50 millimeters. Now, if you want to watch a detailed video regarding this particular problem, I'll leave a link to that in the description down below. You can go ahead and watch it. And I guess all of you have done engineering, and this is basically the general method of constructing an ellipse, and you all must have seen this particular figure, especially in the book of engineering drawing by N.D. Butt. So here we go. Let me tell you something. Length of major axis divided by distance between directrix. So we know the eccentricity is 2/3. Okay, that is known to us. Fine. So length of major axis is how much? This is major axis from here to here. This is 120. So that's 120. Let me check it. Okay, divided by the distance between directrices. Distance between directrix from here C to this C dash. The distance is 180. So 180 and 6, 2 is 12, 6. 3 is 18, so that works out as 2/3. Okay, so this in fact is a formula, you know. And let me use this also. Distance between foci, distance between foci, that is from here until which reach here, that is 80 divided by distance between major axis, or the length of the major axis, that will be very precise. This is 120. So this is 42 is 80 and 43 is 120. So this also works out as 120, as 2/3. So all the options are correct, all of this. Okay, so remember, you need to, guys, there is nothing else, you need to mug up these formulas. Okay, how these formulas are correct, what is their verification, that is something that I've shown you right now. Fine, moving on. 20th problem. The major and minor axis of an ellipse are 100 mm and 60 mm respectively. What will be the distance of its foci from the end of the minor axis? The distance of its foci from the end of minor axis. So here we have the figure. Now guys, watch carefully. AB, how much? 100. And minor axis is 60. This distance, let me show that, this distance from C to F1, there is a mathematical relationship which connects this. CF1 is half of AB, and if you have seen the previous video, you'll know this relationship. CF1 is equal to half of AB. So this is pretty simple. Now half of AB is how much? 100 by 2 is 50. So the distance of this focus from one end point of the minor axis is how much? This is 50, option number C. Next, locus of a point lying on the circumference of a circle. Locus of a point on the circumference of a circle which rolls along a straight line. This is very straightforward. So you've got a circle and you've got a point. Okay, this point, and this is going to roll along a straight line. What is the locus of this point? Okay, this locus is nothing but a cycloid. Watch this completely, and that's a cycloid. Pretty easy problem. Moving on. Name the curve traced out by a point on the circumference of a circle which rolls outside another circle of the same diameter. Okay, the diameter is same. That means this over here is nothing but the directing circle, and this over here, well, I cannot catch it, this is the rolling circle. Both of them are having the same diameters. Well, obviously the profile is going to be cycloid, but what sort of a cycloid? This is sort of making a heart-shaped cycloid, which is technically referred to as a cardioid. I think this animation is going to really help you. This is something that I found on Wikipedia. So big thumbs up for them. Cardioid, that's the right option. Remember, circle, you place a point on that circle's circumference, and if it rolls above another circle, which is also having the same diameter, then the cycloid is a cardioid, you can say. So they shouldn't have given this option over here. This is rather confusing, but again, cardioid is the best option. Moving on. Name the curve traced out by a point on the circumference of a circle. Okay, point is on the circumference, which rolls on another circle of larger diameter. This is pretty obvious. Okay, here we go. Outside, what sort of a curve are you gonna get? What is this name? The name is epicycloid. Pretty simple, very simple. So if it rolls outside, if you make a point on the circumference and if that rolling circle rolls outside, it's an epicycloid. If it rolls inside, it's a hypocycloid. Remember this. And if the rolling circle rolls along a straight line, it's a cycloid. Okay, fine. The curve traced by a point on a straight line. So there is a point on a straight line and not on a circle, like previous examples. Now this straight line is rolling on a circle. So this is in motion and this is rather fixed without slipping. So let us try to work it out. Let's have a circle. Let's have a straight line, okay, which right now is tangential. Let us put it this way. This line or rod is actually rolling along the surface or along the periphery or along the circumference of this circle. And just keep a track of these two points, P and Q. This is how it's going to look. Want to see that again? Let me reverse. Okay. Keep a track of these two points. And this is what we get. This, guys, is nothing but an involute. Remember this. And again, if you've seen the previous video, you can work it out very easily. Okay. Next, when a straight line rolls on the circumference of a semicircle, well, previously it was a circle. Now the straight line is rolling above a semicircle. So it's going to make no difference whatsoever. The locus again is going to be referred to as an involute. And here it is. The reason is here. Same stuff. This also is an involute. That's it. Moving on. And always remember, guys, involute is always connected with gears and gear teeth. So, okay, so this is the right option. A right circular cone when cut by a plane parallel to its generator. So we have a right circular cone and it's got infinite number of generators, and the cutting plane is actually parallel to any one generator, like this. So we've got a generator over here. This is the generator with respect to which this cutting plane is actually parallel. So in this case, you can clearly see this is the semi-vertical angle alpha, and this is the angle that the cutting plane makes with the axis beta. And if these two lines are parallel, then this fellow, this acts as a transversal. Beta is equal to alpha, and when beta is equal to alpha, we know what the right option is. It's a parabola. Okay, remember this, guys, this is extremely important. Again, if you have seen the previous video, you can crack it very easily, or you would have cracked it already before me even telling you. Again, we have another problem on conic sections. When a right circular cone is cut by a plane passing through its apex, the curve obtained is, so we have a cone and we have a cutting plane, and this plane is passing through the apex, something like this. Okay, the curve obtained is, you don't actually get a curve, it's a conic section which is referred to as a triangle. That's it. The curve generated by the rolling contact of one curve over another curve or line is called, it's a roulette, let me tell you. And you can also work this out by eliminating the remaining options. So curve and curve rolling over the other, spiral has nothing to do, helix has nothing to do with this, conic section, well, this has nothing to do with this definition. The only option left is roulette. And let me show you how exactly a roulette looks. Curve rolling over another curve. Watch this illustration. Watch it again. watch it. This is the point. And this green curve actually rolls. This profile that you get is a roulette. Watch it. Okay, so remember this, curve rolling over another curve or line, the profile or the locus of any moving point on the curve is a roulette. Again, a curve generated by a point lying on the circumference of a circle which rolls along a fixed, straight or curved path. So there could be plenty of options. If I make a point over here and if this rolls, this is going to be what? Cycloid, isn't it? If we have a directing circle like this, and if I place a rolling circle like this over here, then if it is going to go for one revolution, this is the profile that I'll get. If I keep it inside, this is the profile that I'll get. So in all the cases, collectively you can say all the curves are collectively referred to as cycloidal curves, provided the point has to lie on the circumference. Okay, it's a cycloidal curve. Next problem is, the curve traced out by a point on the circumference of a circle which rolls on another circle with internal contact. there are two circles in contact. One is going to be fixed, that is directing. One is going to roll, okay, roll inside, internally, something like this. Let me show you rather. The curve traced about by a point on the circumference of a circle which rolls on another circle with internal contact. It's something like this. If you have a directing circle like this, and if I can make this center, and there is going to be a rolling circle somewhere here, okay, with internal contact, it is going to work out a hypocycloid. That's it. So that's the correct answer, hypocycloid. Done and dusted. Moving on to the next problem, and here we go. A curve traced out by a point situated either inside or outside the circle which rolls along a fixed straight line. So let me give you an illustration, guys. If the point is on the circumference, and if when this circle rolls, when you keep a track of this point, this is going to make a cycloid. If say that the point is outside, the curve that we'll get is a trochoid. What kind of a trochoid? It's a superior trochoid. If the point is inside, so you have a curve something like this. This is what you call an inferior trochoid. This would have been very easy for someone who have seen the previous video. So what sort of a curve are you going to get? Whenever the point is either inside or outside, you get a trochoid. Okay, remember this. That's it. Either inside or outside, it's a trochoid. If it is inside, it's a superior. If it's an inferior trochoid, if it is outside, so it's a superior trochoid. So broadly, on a collective sense, the correct option is option C. An involute of a circle is popularly used in, this is going to be very easy, teeth profile. Always connect involute with gear tooths. Involute curve is used in, this is a simple one, again gears. This is sort of a repetitive question, just to make sure, to boost your confidence. Okay, have you seen this one? Yeah. A curve traced out by a point moving uniformly along a straight line towards the pole, while the saline revolves about one of its ends with uniform angular velocity. You should know this. It's something like this. Let me say, we have a link over here. Okay, and there is a point right here. This link again is sort of moving in a rotational motion. It is carrying out a rotatory motion. This point is going to shift slightly, say here. Then the link comes over here. Then the point shifts further here. In this way, this is going to make a profile which is referred to as what? An Archimedean spiral. Again, if you have seen the previous video, this was very easy. And finally, the last problem. A curve traced out by a point moving around the surface of a cylinder or cone with uniform speed and with uniform axial movement. So in case of a cylinder in case of a cone, it's something like this. Let me show you with the help of a very simple illustration. And let me have a blue color. So the point moves like this. Okay, if it moves along the surface and it has some upward movement also, constant upward movement, then the locus is what you know as a helix. And same is with cone also. Here, like this. This is a conical helix, and this one is a cylindrical helix. That's the only difference. So broadly, the answer is option D. So guys, that was all for today. I'll see you again in the next video, which I'll be doing on orthographic prediction. And let's see, I'll take on some problems based on projection of points also. So guys, that was all for today. I'll see you again in the next video. Until then, take care and have a nice day. Thanks for watching.